like to call tonight's meeting to order, regular scheduled meeting for January 12th, 2010, our first meeting for the calendar year at 6:00. I would like to make a brief announcement. I do not know the details, but before we take a moment of silence, I'd like for you to, during that moment, to give prayer and thought to Robert Reeves, our commissioner. I understand he's in the hospital and having had heart difficulties yesterday. I don't know more than that at this time, but keep the Reeves family in your thoughts and prayers, please. At this time, I would ask everyone to take a moment with the board in a moment of silence. Amen. If you would, rise. I have to say the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have a guest tonight that's signed for public comments. The first to be recognized is Ms. Gwen Williams.
Good evening. I'm a teacher at the high school in Southern Lee, and I'm a lifelong resident of this county. And I would like to express a lot of concerns that I have regarding this proposed school calendar. This is an issue that's brought much confusion to parents, students, teachers, and taxpayers in our county. It's also an issue about, I believe, trying to skirt around a law that was passed in 2004 to protect the summers for families. This new calendar is going to take away family time. I will have to report for duty on the 2nd of August. My children will not report until the 25th of August. So that leaves 23 days that I've got to find childcare, and it will have a major impact on my family, both personally and financially. I believe that there has been a lack of information and a lack of legitimate proof regarding the proposed calendar change. The calendar is basically the same as Lee Early College. So why not promote Lee Early College? Roughly 150, according to the Sanford Herald, responded in favor of the survey. This is going to affect immediately 3,000 families at least. Why vote something in when it only was approved by about 150 people in our county? The second thing that worries me is the beneficial change to every student in the county. Only a handful of students that I've taught for the past 13 years graduate early. And I believe in our society now, it's not because the options aren't there. We have courses online that they can take. We have Lee Early College. Seated classes at CCCC and Sand Hills do not begin until this week. And drop ad is until next Friday, when exams are over and the students can dual enroll. I did ask about that. Also, the proven that they're graduating early in 3.5 years instead of 4.5 years. That's been the case in my personal experience as a teacher. A lot of times they are working on this in 4.5 years. We have our programs in place where the students can earn this college credit, like the e-college and the other things that they can take online. So I feel like that's one of the things they should be advised to do. Also, the football schedule. I looked at all of the playing schedules for all the teams we compete against. Every team started their first game on August 21st. They're all on the same calendar as we are. So I don't think that's an argument either. The fifth concern I have is the lack of choices. Tramway is a year-round school, and that is a choice that parents make. Lee Early College is a choice that they can make. By imposing this on us, that is not going to be a choice. I'm going to be told that's what I've got to do. And the last thing I would just ask for you to do is to please vote no on this calendar change. You know, we should keep in mind that we're trying to promote good school and community relations under our policy code through Lee County 7300. And I don't think that has been done. Personally, in my class, the only class that was affected, I had two students return the calendar. One voted against it, one voted for it. The one that voted for it, her comment to me was she had nothing better to do in the summertime. The girl that voted against it, her family has a child with Down syndrome at Floyd L. Knight. She is his primary caregiver when her mother's not at home. And there is not a child care center in the county that will accept him because of his disability. He cannot go to Stepping Stones. He can't go to some of the other programs because of his disability. So I'm just asking you to please vote no on this until we have further research. Thank you.
Thank you. Donna Anstead. Lisa Saunders.
Good evening, how are you?
Hello.
Good. I'm here to give some positive comments relating to the newly proposed high school calendar. Because this is my first year having a child in high school, my comments will be more so for the parents who have students participating in the various programs offered by the high school. However, something that would affect my child in this with this new calendar would be that the first semester would end on December the 21st, which would actually enable our students to take their exams prior to the holiday break. This, I believe, would not only be a dramatic improvement in the students' grades on their exams, but I also believe that it would be a reward for the teachers' efforts in that course of study, because the students could take their exams while the information is fresher in their minds. For the students who are participating in the athletics program, such as softball, baseball, football, golf, their year of practice has already started. So therefore, I believe this early start to the school year would actually be a plus for them and their parents. I don't know why I'm trembling there. That is so silly of me. Anyway, therefore, I believe this early start to the school year would actually be a plus for them, because their parents wouldn't have, well, the buses would be running, and their parents wouldn't have to alter their schedule to accommodate taking their students to practice in early August due to the school already being in session. This would also apply to the students who are in the band and orchestra who have early starts to their year also. So that's my comment. I hope you forgive me for trembling up there. Hope you go get some.
Thank you. Chris Williams.
Good evening. My name is Chris Williams. I'm the parent of two children in the Lee County school systems, grade 5th and grade 7th. I do not support the calendar change for high school only. If this change is going to be made, it needs to be made and done with all of the schools to the same calendar. As a parent, I was never surveyed on the changing calendar, even though I have two students in the school system, 5th and 7th grade. My number one concern is the calendar proposal does not meet the standards set by the state of North Carolina to seek waivers. According to the information from the Department of Public Instruction, waivers are for counties affected by weather for more than 8 days or a program for meeting the needs of a specific target group of students. According to the information in the Sanford Herald, our county is not seeking to change the calendar for those reasons. If the calendar is approved by the state, it may cause Lee County to lose great teachers with proven track records, high test scores, and a proven ability to other counties such as Harnett, Moore, or Chatham, where the schools follow the same schedules. Another concern is that families are given no choice and/or options if they cannot manage childcare with the schedule or they do not want to be on different schedules. We have a year-round elementary school that is a choice. We have a Lee Early College that is a choice. This calendar gives high school students and teachers no choices. There will be added costs to school employees and families who must find childcare for their elementary and middle school children. According to the information on the DPI website, Lee County has a higher graduation rate than the state average. How will the calendar improve this? No information was provided or that found. It really is disturbing to think that the superintendent and Lee County School Board is considering making such a quick change without doing any research and allowing more input from the taxpayers and parents of our county. Where is the documentation to support your claims? The decision will cause too much confusion in our county as well as take away time from this county's families. And as far as the athletics go, I have a student that's in basketball in seventh grade, and it's a choice. We can make arrangements to pick them up after school, Friday night practices, things of that nature. It's not nothing that it's mandatory. So by us putting them in that program, it's our choice to make sure we're there early, drop them off, and looking after them, not the school's responsibility. So I would ask you to vote no on this proposal and yes on the traditional calendar. And thanks for your time.
Thank you. At this time, I take a motion to approve tonight's agenda. Ms. Main.
I would ask for us to have an amendment to the agenda to add number 7 under action items, new business C, and that be system-wide calendar waiver request with the exception of Tremway.
So item 7 is LEA calendar waiver. Is that a way of stating?
That's a better way of saying it.
LEA calendar waiver. Anyone else? Being no objection from the board, I ask for a motion to approve the revised calendar. I mean, a revised agenda.
Mr. Chair, I move that we would approve the revised agenda.
Second.
Second by Mr. Sharp. All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. This moment I'd like to recognize action motion from a member of the board to approve the minutes from December 8th and December 15th, 2009.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we accept the regular board meeting minutes for December the 8th and December the 15th.
Do I have a second? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. This time we'll have reports and announcements, and I'd like to before I recognize Ms. Grimes, I would like to remind the board that on Thursday the 14th, we do have scheduled and registration at the state level for the required by state legislature school board ethics training. It begins at 1 o'clock at the North Carolina School Board Association's Assembly Hall on Falls of the Neuse Road. If you'll notify Ms. Britt that if we carpool, if there's any interest in carpooling, let Ms. Britt know. Also, a reminder to the board that we have the scheduled board work session call board meeting at 5 o'clock on January 25th. Any topics that you have that you would like to convey at that work session, please notify Ms. Britt. Ms. Britt, the superintendent and I are working now on the agenda for that meeting. Now, it's a privilege to, that I ask Ms. Emily Grimes, who is a Fort Berry School liaison officer, to address the board to help us understand our role in assisting her in liaison to Fort Bragg.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Moss. First, I'd like to thank you for providing me with the opportunity to talk a little bit about the role of the school liaison officer. Very succinctly, I serve as the primary point of contact between military families and public schools. Our garrison commander is equivalent to a city mayor. He's very interested in the educational pursuits of our military families. However, he can't be in all places at all times. So he dispatches his school liaison officers to various school systems that are close to the installation. Since December 2008, I've been assigned to Lee County Schools. I also work with some of Cumberland and all the Fort Bragg schools. Again, the primary point of contact between the families and the school system. I accomplish this role by five key functions. The first one is transition support, assisting families who move in and out of communities, families who move into Lee County wanting to know more about schools, providing information so that they can be informed educational consumers. This involves sometimes records transfer, contacting soldiers' units, verifying residency for soldiers, or other information that school personnel ask us to verify. A second key function has to do with installation school communication, and that is accomplished best by visiting schools. I've visited all the schools in Lee County, with the exception of the Child Center. I have briefed new teachers, counselors, principals. Dr. Moss attends meetings at the installation twice a year. So we try to be good neighbors and have a good stream of communication between the installation and myself. Another key function is partnerships in education. That involves inviting schools to events on the installation. For example, we have a career fair annually, and a couple of years ago, someone from Bragg Academy brought some students out. And we try to host events that are open to the general public, not just the military-connected students, but to the general population as well. Another means of being good partners, we hope, is by having a policy that says scheduled parent-teacher conferences are the soldier's place of duty. Two key words, mission permitting, because of course the mission always comes first. However, if a teacher has a military parent that they really need to see during these conferences, there is a master policy on the installation that says that is the soldier's place of duty. That's the type of information we want educators to know about, so if there are issues, they can contact us. Okay? And I say us because there are four school liaison officers on the installation. However, I am assigned to Lee County. Okay? We are the primary conveyors of information, particularly with the Interstate Compact on Educational Opportunity for Military Children. That is a law that was signed in 2008 that is designed to facilitate transitions for military-connected students. It looks at records transfer, it looks at acceptance of credit, assignments, things like that. Homeschool support is another key function. Many of our families opt to homeschool, and what we do is to ensure that they do it the right way. We ask them to please not pull children out of school until they have declared the notice of intent through the Department of Non-Public Education and gotten authorization for that. So we do work in tandem with the school system. We consider ourselves partners, and at no time do we ask for exception to policies. We don't ask to circumvent policies. We do ask for consideration for the unique challenges that our children bring. Our children move 6 to 9 times, different schools, every 2 to 3 years. Most high schoolers will have gone to at least 2 high schools. So that brings some unique challenges to any school system. So we do ask for consideration for that. The fifth key function involves post-secondary opportunities and information. We host career fairs, I think I mentioned that, college fairs, military academy fairs, financial aid workshops, and those are all open to the public as well. They are not just for military-connected students. We disseminate the information to the counselors or other school personnel, and your students are invited to attend those as well. Essentially, as a school liaison officer, I hope that I am a conduit of information and goodwill, a resource sharer, and the go-to person for school personnel who have questions about any military-connected issues. We've been able to identify about 186 students in the Lee County Schools who are military-connected. That's based upon those who have completed the federal card, so we know that there are more. We have good relationships. I can pick up the phone and call Susan at any time or any number of persons, and I've been very well received at all the schools in Lee County. So, in a nutshell, I'm the primary point of contact between the school system and the installation. I look forward to working with you all. Any questions?
Right.
Yes, I have a question. What is your projection of the number of kids that we will get in Lee County during the transition of BRAC?
Tough question, because 11 counties are vying for these same children, and we have no way of knowing at this time where the families are going. I participated in the relocation fair in Atlanta, and most folks had not made a determination as to which county they were going to come to at that time. So, sorry, tough question.
Do you have any idea when we'll know that?
When they arrive in the house. Unfortunately, that's because we're trying to get that information as well. But many have not committed. Many have older children. So school systems won't be affected, but for those who have younger children, they simply have not committed because they're being courted by all these different counties. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Emily, are you the contact person also for any private schools within the community, our community, or another county?
Only public schools.
Only public schools.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The most we do is we provide a list of private schools, mm-hmm. but we work primarily with the public school systems. Yeah.
Any other questions? Yeah. Anybody else? Emily, I have a question, not to put you on the spot or the administration. Okay. How have you found Lee County schools in working in cooperation with you and your needs?
Oh, excellent. Excellent. As I said, I've been well received. We've had some issues that we've had to work through, but we've resolved all of them quickly and all civilly. So, yes.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Dr. Moss, Superintendent's Report.
Members of the board, let me first of all say that Emily has done an outstanding job and has helped us in some very touchy situations at times, but she's an excellent advocate for military families. Let me first call on Aaron Fleming to give you an idea of what is occurring with our Habitat House. I think some of you may or may not know, we have a partnership and we're doing some green construction right off of Hawkins Drive.
Thank you, Mr. Superintendent, Mr. Chairman, and board members. It is good to be here this evening, and I appreciate the opportunity to very quickly go over a little bit or something we're doing. It's fairly unique. I'll begin by quoting a popular philosopher of our time, Kermit the Frog, and he once said, "It's not easy being green." So hopefully, through this presentation, you will see that it is pretty easy, and we're doing some good things for students. Talk to you a little bit about what exactly are we doing. We received a Golden Leaf Opportunities for Work grant. This was a special project that Golden Leaf Foundation was doing in response to the current economic situation. Golden Leaf, as you probably know, is a foundation created by the state to manage the tobacco settlement money. And so they give this money out for various different types of programs, primarily in tobacco-affected counties. But we were able to get the Golden Leaf Glow Grant. And in that grant, we said that we were going to build a home, our students would build a home with green elements. And those green elements consist of different renewable and sustainable components, and I'll get into that in just a second. The other part of the grant we put in there that we would have student industry recognized credentials from NCCER, which is the National Center for Construction, Education, and Research, along with Green Advantage, which is another organization that students can test for a credential that they understand Energy Star, that they understand the components of green construction. Habitat for Humanity here in Sanford would receive the completed home. I'm pleased to see Mr. Gary Wicker here, representing Habitat for Humanity. They will receive that home, and they have already put quite a bit into the home as they have funded the foundation to the house, which we will see some photos here in a moment. And one main component is the fact that we're not expecting students to go out and build a home as soon as they're finished with the project, but hopefully we sparked an interest in them for the construction industry, particularly green, sustainable, renewable construction energy, and also that they do walk away with some skills. Once again, maybe not necessarily so they can just go and build a house the next week, but certainly they would have some skills within them within the construction trade. The budget for the project is just under $98,000. To break that down, a significant portion of it will be for the building materials, including those renewable and sustainable elements. The instructional materials and the credentialing exam from NCCER and Green Advantage, they are within that. Students, and I think I put in their exam, it's actually exams. They will take several credentialing exams throughout the project. It includes their tuition. Those students are enrolled at Central Carolina Community College during the day, but in the evenings and on Saturdays. They are students in continuing education courses, that covers their tuition and the salaries of the instructors. The instructors during the day are Lee County Schools CTE teachers, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. And then also the miscellaneous operating expenses, your tap fees. I had the city put the driveway in. Obviously, the city did the water and sewer taps, dumpsters, portable toilets, the electrical connection to the pole. So what will be green within the house? You hear a lot about green and green elements. The home will, and I put should, assuming all goes as planned, the home will meet the government's Energy Star standards, which is a 14 SEER heating air conditioning system. Insulation, and if you're taking notes, the R value of 15 and 38, 15 in the walls, 38 in the ceiling. The windows have to be Energy Star rated. The appliances, lighting have to be Energy Star Energy Star rated. And then everything in the house has to be sealed, your corners, where the house comes down to the foundation, in the ceiling, in the rafters, insulation, foam sealed, taped, however. And probably the most interesting one is the fact that we will integrate some solar energy into the house. We specifically wrote this into the grant. Right now we're looking, it may expand from this, but right now at least the hot water will be solar within the house. It is certainly a partnership without the funding from the Golden Leaf Foundation, Lee County Schools, Central Carolina Community College, Habitat for Humanity for all the help, people, money they have put into it. And we have to mention Progress Energy and the Lee County Home Builders Association, who really wrote the letters and really stood behind this grant as it went through the process with the folks in Rocky Mountain Golden Leaf. So what about these students again? They are Lee County School students during the day and in the evening, and on the weekends they are students of Central Carolina Community College. They are receiving high school technical credit for these courses. They're added on just like electives. They go within their pathway. So you hear a lot about career pathways, career clusters. Well, this is a major component of it for these students. The Lee County Schools instructors, Mr. Gary Hart, Mr. Quinn Henry, Mr. Hart's a Southern Lee High School construction teacher. Mr. Henry is new to us this year. He's a construction teacher at Lee County High School. They are employed outside the school day
by CC to teach this class. They are fully credentialed themselves by NCCER. And then the class schedule, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 4 to 6, and Saturday, 8 to 12. Some of that split up between classroom time and lab time, which the lab is on Poplar Avenue off of Hawkins, where the house is. I feel sorry for them in these last few days when they're building the house and the temperature that they're building. Real quickly about the credentials. The first credential that students will test into are what they call the core curriculum. It's a credential that simply says they know the safety standards set by OSHA. They know introductory skills within trades, you know, how to use a hammer, how to measure twice, cut once, so to speak. Just those very general skills. And then Carpentry 1, which is fundamentals, is what they'll be doing next. And then finishing and framing is Carpentry 2. So there's three already. If time permits, we would like to get them into 3 and 4, which are the top two NCCER credentials, which is an advanced carpentry. If the money can hold out that long and the house is not finished completely at the time, we hope to get those students into that. And then one thing we definitely will do is the environmental certification for Green Advantage and get those students ready for that and hopefully pass it. Here's one photo, not a whole lot to see there. This was back in December, I believe December 12th. The foundation, just below the decking there, the foundation was built by the volunteers from Habitat for Humanity. Everything above that is our responsibility. So you can see from this picture, we have a little bit of a ways to go. That's our sign in the front and the foundation and the house in the back. Like I said, December 12th, you can see how far they got before the holiday break. This was January 6th. I have a better picture. Here we go. We've got the walls pretty much up on the house. And these most recent pictures right here. So as you can see, they have gotten quite a distance on. And be happy to entertain any questions you have. Like I said, I certainly do appreciate it. And there's Kermit for everybody. So.
I had a question.
Yes.
How many students are involved in this class here?
Right now we've got 12. We actually started out with, I believe, 14. Two have left the program for various reasons. There have been some issues with students not wanting to commit the time that it requires. I mean, you're asking a lot of time from the students. So I believe now we're down to 12. As this new semester starts up with these students, we are going to add probably two more back in, two new students that have at least received that core, so they won't be behind a whole lot. They've received the core within their classes, within their trade industrial classes in high school, so they shouldn't be too far behind. The rest of them that are in there, we may lose a couple more just because they'll graduate.
Does a normal kid that's taking this extra, it's like an extra class, would they be taking four other classes? And
yes, they have four other classes during the day.
That's very impressive.
Yes, it mm-hmm. is. And we really tried to target this program, and not all the students may fit within this description, mm-hmm. but, you know, towards the at-risk youth. Mm-hmm. And the good thing is, because it is a CC class they're in, if they do graduate this spring, if mm-hmm. and we're going to try to talk to some of them, if they want to come back, their tuition is still paid for because they fall within that grant. And it is, they would be enrolled at Central Carolina Community College. Mm-hmm. Now, it is a continuing ed class, so they can't apply that towards a degree program mm-hmm. or anything, but certainly the skills they're learning may outweigh that for many of them.
Mm-hmm. What grades are they? Lot of students right now.
Right now they are all juniors and seniors, I'm pretty sure. That was where we targeted the grant for, and I'm almost positive they're all 11th and 12th grade.
Aaron, is this a one-shot deal, or is it a possibility we can get future grants from future homes?
Officially, it is a one-shot deal. Who knows if they'll have the GLOW grant again? Who knows if Golden Leaf will allow us to apply through the regular grant cycle through this? The hope is, yes, it would be continuing. And matter of fact, if we go through the process and we say, oh, we forgot about this, or it would be better to do this, we're writing those down for the next time in hopes that there is a next time. I think if you talk to the instructors, they just finished at 6, and they said they've been going over a little bit. because the students are excited about what they're doing. I think they will tell you they've seen, even just in a semester, or really not even a semester, if we started late, they've seen a change in those students.
When this house is taken over by, it's going to be given to Habitat for
That's
Humanity.
Correct.
All right, and one part of that philosophy is that they have go through that sweat equity.
Sweat
How
equity.
Is that going to be worked out?
We have on Saturdays and even in the evenings, we've worked, and Mr. Wicker may be able to speak to it a little bit more, but we have committed to Habitat that that family that has been chosen. Does put some work into it, that it won't be all us, primarily probably on the weekends, the Habitat leaders will work with those families to assist our students.
Is all that accurate?
Yes. It's a single mom that has two children, one in the school system and one that's older, that is wheelchair bound. She has difficulty going to the job site on Saturdays, but I think when the weather warms up, she'll be there. She's been working in the Restore beside, I believe, Buildemar, and she has put in a number of hours already. They have to have 400 total. And she has a friend that has been helping, so their hours are starting to mount. But we want them on the job site. We want them taking part in that. I hope that when this cold weather goes away, that we'll see her out there a little more.
There's a lot in the project too. I didn't mention this, not included in the grant. Obviously, there'll have to be a little bit of landscaping, yard work, and so hopefully we can get our other students as well as that family involved in some of the other components that we may not touch on.
Because this house is not taking the place of the two regular Carpenter houses.
That's correct. At Southern Lee High School, we do still have the project house that that money is sold, auctioned off in June. That money is rolled back into the current technical education program.
Mr. Thompson actually asked one of my questions, but where's the house located?
House located on Poplar Street, Mr. Wicker. What's the street address? 221?
224.
224 Poplar Street. Real easy if you come from downtown Sanford, you're going up Hawkins towards US 1. It's the next street past Hill Street. Take a left onto Poplar. Second lot on the left.
22 something.
There's a house being built, a big sign in the front yard.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Don't be tearing things up. Mr. Chairman, the next item is just an update on our advanced ed. Sachs Casey visit that will occur. You have the information from Sunday the 28th through March the 3rd. As part of that visit, they will interview each and every one of you. They'd like to interview you separately, but they will do groups if necessary. They do understand that some of you have employment, and they'll work around your employment schedule as well, whether it be an evening session, dinner session, or some point in time. They'll be here for dinner on that Sunday. Mr. Chairman, we'd like to invite you and the Vice Chair to have dinner with them as well. And then we'll provide you the schedule, and Mr. Bryan will arrange the time for your interviews through that week. Any questions on the visit? Third thing, it's a reminder, February 11th, we will have Paxton Patterson here to kick off the STEM partnership that will be at San Lee. It will be also incorporated into an after hours with the chamber. We'll begin at 5. We will have both Dr. June Atkinson, the state superintendent, as well as Dr. Bill Harrison, state board chair, here for that evening. And the owner of Paxton Patterson will be here as well. I think he's also speaking at the committee 100 that day as well. You also have in your packet the rollout for the one-to-one laptop program. You have that timeline. We've started that process of staff development and have received glowing remarks from the participants so far. I think they're very excited and the students are very excited. And that's my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Committee reports at this time. Mrs. Mangum, curriculum and instruction.
High school C&I committee met on December the 9th. instructional updates discussed with high schools that workshop, the newly proposed calendar, visitation between schools, race to the top money, financial literacy planning, and training for health education teachers on abstinence and new laws for the next semester. The new high school course selection guide was reviewed and will be presented this evening for approval. Tomorrow, the middle school committee will meet at San Lee, and on January 20th, 7th, the elementary committee will meet at Deep River.
Thank you. Facilities and Technologies, Dr. Smith.
Mr. Chairman, the Facilities and Technology Committee met on Monday, January the 4th. We had a nice presentation from Mr. Lee McClure, who has a construction management firm. Was a good presentation. We also approved the capital improvement budget that's in everybody's packet. The most important thing in there probably is how we plan to increase our capacity at our elementary schools. And of course, that's in the consent agenda. We meet next on Tuesday, January 19th, 3 o'clock.
Thank you. Mr. Thompson, Finance and Personnel.
Mr. Chairman, the Finance and Personnel Committee has not met since December. We have another meeting scheduled, I think, the 25th of this month.
Mr. Wiggins, Policy.
Policy Committee has not met since December. We'll be having one January. January 19th.
Thank you. For those in the audience, we do have some policies unfinished on second reading, the policies tonight, and also some policies on first reading to follow. At this time, we have a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I so move.
We have a second.
Second.
Any questions or comments?
Mr. Chair. The only thing that I have any problems with in the consent agenda is the CIP, the area where we're discussing expansion of the elementary schools. And I think in the previous 4 or 5 years, we have looked at adding a new school. And I just am a little concerned about our elementary schools becoming a little too large. I know this is just a working document that's not anything is written in stone, but I would like to see a discussion in the future about how large we want our elementary schools to become.
Any other comments?
Chair, not on really an approval, just on thought that during previous administration, we passed a policy that dealt with field trips, overnight, the expenditure of money, and either we need to rescind that or look at that because we have a lot of overnight field trips that are within our geographical area.
Can you address that at your next policy meeting?
Yes, sir.
For clarity.
Yes, sir.
Any other? All in favor of the consent agenda, signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Unfinished business. Mr. Williams, second reading, board policies.
Second reading of board policy, for the second reading is policy 3200. Excuse me, let me start again, Mr. Chairman. Move that Lee County Board of Education approve the second reading of policies 3200, 3420, 3515, 4120, 4130, 4540, 6220, 6225, 6230, and 8720. And rescind policy 4140.
Motion is coming from committee. It does not require a second. Any questions or discussions on any of these policies at this time? Being none, all those in favor of the motion before you, signify by aye. Opposed? New business. Mr. Williams, first reading, board policies.
Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approve the first reading of policy 1710, 1720, and 3460.
This again is coming from policy, does not require a second. Any questions? Mr. Williams? Being none, all in favor of the motion before you, signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Mr. Williams? The agenda has editorial changes for board policies, so would you like to? Let's say that shouldn't really be on there, it should be, that's information.
Yes, sir.
At this time, item three, traditional elementary, middle, and high school calendars. It will require a motion from the board member and a second, as it's not coming from a standing committee, so I'm going to take a motion to approve the calendar as presented.
Which calendar are we talking about now?
Which one?
The elementary, middle, and high school calendars. The three calendars that is before the board in our package tonight. I have a motion to approve the, or a motion to approve.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve the calendars for the three calendars, elementary, middle, and high school.
A second.
Second. Now, the chair will recognize any comments or discussions or questions.
Mr. Chairman, I don't think anybody in this audience or elsewhere would have any problem with the motion on the floor to approve the calendars, and I'm speaking specifically the high school calendar, and nobody would disagree with the idea of having our students finish their exams before their fall Christmas break. However, if we approve that high school schedule, it's my opinion that we're going to place a fair-sized burden on our parents, our family, certainly on our faculty. And certainly, when I thought about it for a little while, with our current exam exemption policy, a fair number of children don't even take their exams. So the real issue here, as I see it, is the starting date imposed on us by the State Board of Education, which is August the 25th. And obviously, any diversion from that August 25th date is going to place burdens on our parents and faculty. It would be my hope that we could postpone the enactment of this policy until, and if the State Board of Education and the state legislature could be persuaded to return to local boards of education the authority to establish school calendars, then we could have it both ways. We can give our high school students the benefit of the doubt, let them finish exams before Christmas break, and not overburden our parents and faculty and families with having to deal with multiple school calendars. That way, we can have a win-win situation and not overburden any segment of our population. So it would be my hope that we do not pass the high school calendar until such time as the state board can relinquish and give us the authority to establish our schedule.
I think that was very well said, Dr. Smith, and I think we need to get with Jimmy Love on our, from a legislative standpoint. But I still would like to ask the superintendent a couple, you know, just a couple of questions about, I'm not sure from an academic standpoint that it may be the way to go, but I'd just like to ask you, why do you think this calendar is the best for every student in the county?
Well, I think you have to look at each grade level and decide what would work best within that configuration. At the elementary and middle schools, they don't have the competition or the comp- competing element of having to take a course within 90 days and then perform well on a state assessment or any exam. It is, I think, there's a lot of research both ways, and I think a lot of the research would suggest that any time a student is away from the classroom, from curriculum, just like over the summertime, you have a dip in knowledge. That's why when you walk through many of our classrooms at the beginning of a school year, you'll see teachers reviewing what they taught last year. If students retain knowledge and they don't dip, then when you walk in on the first day of school, there should not be a repeat of anything from the previous year. The teacher should actually be picking up on where they were last year. Now, at the high school level, it's different. But at K-8, when you walk in, you'll see review. If we believe that time away does not matter, then when you walk in on August 25th, you would see no review. You'd see them pick up from where they should. At the high school level, they do pick up from where they should because it is taught on that subject. They don't have the ability to review, even though they see the dip as well. So giving the opportunity to take the exam prior to being out for 2 weeks, I think would have a positive effect on student achievement. You really can't compare the achievement from previous years when we were able to give the exam prior to Christmas because the exam has changed. So it would be almost like comparing apples to oranges. The tests have changed over the course of time since the calendar legislation has been enacted. So if I compared student achievement, say, at Lee County High School when they were on a semester that ended at Christmas to where they are today, you may see a decline, you may see an increase, but you really couldn't say it was because of the calendar because I think the test has changed that much. So although I could point to something, I wouldn't hang my hat on it and say that's the reason you see a difference in the calendar change. We do have some students that graduate early. It's not the majority of them, but we have this year over 450 students just at Lee County High School that are participating in distance learning or some kind of virtual learning, which that calendar typically mirrors a college schedule or a college calendar, especially if it's a UNCGI course, which is University of North Carolina Greensboro, or a course that's taught online at a community college. That course would typically mirror a semester calendar. That's the academic side of it. Athletically, our students are at practice August 1st. That's when football practice begins. Their games may not begin until the 20th, but the practice begins on the 1st. So they are actually in school. Whether or not they're in class doesn't matter, but they are in school. They're participating. Even you looking at the early start calendar, there would still be days that they would not be in school, that they would be at practices.
Well, I've heard a lot about football through the paper and from talking to community, and I would just hope that this schedule would not be just, you know.
No, it's not just because of football. It is truly an academic-based calendar, and the committee brought it up one day. They were having discussions, and Andy can address how it came up, but the committee brought up the possibility, they asked the question, why can our students not take the exams before Christmas? And then I think that is how all of this got generated and information got disseminated out to the schools, and surveys were done and requests for feedback.
Well, nobody, I don't think anybody up here loves football any more than I do, but I think we ought to be in the business of graduating students without most of the priority.
And I think the other component, what's going to become more important to teachers as well, is as North Carolina pursues race to the top, and I know that's further on down on your agenda, student performance will become part of their evaluation. That's a given. You have to do that if you want the funding. So if I'm teaching at a high school and I'm teaching U.S. history, or civics and economics or biology or algebra or any course, once I give that test, how those students perform now is part of my evaluation as a teacher. As a teacher, I would want the highest performance possible. So you have to think, is it better to test a student while the knowledge is fresh? Or is it best to wait 2 weeks, bring them back for a week and a half, and then test them? Where do you get the better test results? And logically, you would think your better test results would be while you were involved in the course. So I don't think it wasn't a driving issue, but I think it's going to be a benefit to teachers if the calendar is passed, that a year from now, when student performance is part of their evaluation, especially at the high school level. Now, it will not matter K-8 because they test in at the end of the school year. But at the high school level, for a teacher's evaluation now to incorporate student achievement, you would want, I would think, your students to be at a position or a point in time when they perform at their peak so that you have a better evaluation than you would if you wait to January.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to just chime in here based on what Dr. Moss has said. Being a former high school teacher, you're going to have added value, added momentum if that exam is given prior to the Christmas holidays. Being in that classroom, you have that momentum set. Okay, say I am, okay, I've taught physics for a while or chemistry. And then when you're going along, you're teaching that, and there's always built into your teaching always a review. That's for me. There's always that review. And then if that child leaves for the Christmas break, almost 2 weeks, and you come back, you have lost that, I say, the added momentum or added value to your teaching. And you will find yourself as a high school teacher almost trying to cram in and get all of that said so that that child will be successful on an exam. And so I see what we have presented here in the calendar, I see it as an advantage.
Well, that is true, Dr. Smith. What's taking us this long to go to where we're trying to go?
Well, I think, anything, over time is going to, you have changes over time. Okay, for a long time, we were on the semester, at our high schools. And like you said, this took place when we were on the semester system. We would always have the exam, before Christmas. But then after we had, we took a block and, system and everything, things changed. And so I think a lot of times, again, I don't know if there is some vertical or horizontal study, whatever, has been done to show that students will lose a lot over that vacation period. That's a long time. And when you come back as a teacher, you have to really rev up with a whole lot of energy to try to get those students back to where, they were before they left for the holiday.
Mr. Chair, a few questions. Block schedules in place prior to the new calendar law coming into effect. When did the students take the exams?
Prior to the new calendar, they took their exams in December.
They took them prior to the new calendar under the block schedule. They took the exams before they went out on the
break. Well, that depends. If they were on an A-B schedule, meaning alternating weeks on a block, they took them at the end of the year. But if you're on a 4x4 block, you took your exams in December. For the most part, I don't personally know of a school system when the option was local, when locally you could decide what the calendar would be. Now, obviously, what you did was design a calendar for K-12. It wasn't just 9, 12, and K-8 then. So everyone was coming back in August, and that put everyone on the same schedule. But I don't personally know of a school system that was on the block schedule that did not give their exams prior to going home at Christmas.
Okay. Are we as a school system trying to enact something that nobody else in the state has done? Or is there another system that already has enacted this and has the calendar change already in place?
No, there are quite a few that have the waivers in place that are not associated with weather. And the DPI, I think they're listed on the website as well. Mm-hmm. But, I know Guilford County has varying calendars for varying high schools.
There were about 8 or 9.
Martin County, Hope County. There are counties within the state that have asked for this waiver for educational purposes.
And my question is, looking at those counties that have done that, are their scores any better?
Well, I think a lot goes into determining whether a score is better. I wouldn't want to compare us to a magnet school in Guilford County and determine whether or not that high school, which does outperform us, is outperforming us because of teacher quality or student quality, because they have a different clientele. I think you have to look at the demographics as well. If you look at Hope County, and I'm familiar with Hope County, I know that that is was the poorest county in the state of North Carolina. It's probably 70% minority at the high school. And I don't know what their test scores are, but you can find them on the report card. But I know they've been recognized as making achievement jumps in the last few years after they've changed their calendar.
Okay, and I guess my question is, you said there's studies that are going both ways. Some that are showing taking the test early is better, some that are showing that the results are less. Are we seeing from those counties that the testing is better for those students?
When I say that, Mr. Williams, what I'm saying really is I can find research to support anything I say.
And that's dangerous, then.
That's just honest. I mean, I can. There's enough research out there. I can find a study that would support anything I would sit up here and say. But what I can truly say, I believe, is that any time you have a break, you lose knowledge. You lose momentum. That is consistent in every study. But I could find a study to say anything you wanted me to say.
But then one of the last ones is the survey that took place for grades K through 12?
No. And I can explain why. As when we discussed it from the committee, it was determined that we needed to survey those that would be immediately impacted. And that would be grades 8 through 11. They will be your next year's high school students, and the next year's high school's families would be grades 8 through 11. They would be the one that would have to face this calendar initially.
Okay. Is there?
We did survey all staff at both high schools.
Okay. Do we have? Well, I know how many voted for. Even here tonight, some discussion. What was the staff's take from the two high schools?
I'll have to let Mr. Bryan discuss that.
Percentage of that one favor?
Oh, give me numbers. I don't like percentages. Can you say 102, 61?
There was if I may just cite a couple of percentages, and then let me get the numbers.
Okay.
Okay. With the staff, there was a 48% return rate. Each of them had an email sent to them to their school email, and had time to respond to that. And their response rate was 74% in favor of it. And I don't have the numbers with me. I apologize. So I just had the percent rate on percent that said yes, which is 74.
Okay.
Which is out of total number of surveys that were sent out were around 350.
And that's from our staff, that we got a 48% return rate.
Yes. Via email.
Okay. Okay. Thanks, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I've thought about this a whole bunch. And a lot of things have gone about. One is the early college schedule. That was instituted 4 years ago under the Gates Foundation, and it was to last for 4 years under that guise of the Gates Foundation. They would pay it, and after that, it would be up to the local government to pay it. This being the last year, am I correct, Dr. Malter?
One more.
This
There's this year and one more.
This year and one more. I don't think that Lee County is going to assume the cost of paying. This is just an assumption. And with the conditions of Lee County revenues and the cuts that we've been through, I'm going to assume the cost of Lee Early College as it stands today. So if that happens, then we've got 350 kids coming back to high school. And if we don't adjust the schedule to the community college, then it's going to be difficult to send kids to the community college to get credit anyway. And as far as the waiting on the legislature to move the schedule back to August the 25th or something like that, I think I was, well, I hate to say this, but I said it would snow in Florida, but it did this week. But I don't look forward to the day that the legislature is going to move, or as long as we have one senator in charge up there, that the schedule will move as it is today from the legislature. I just don't expect that. Been asked before. Also, we're asking for a waiver. There's no guarantee that we'll get it. But I would like to try this schedule for a year to see the work that we can continue, not only with the Lee Early College, but with the students that are now working with the college and taking other courses in this that you're talking about, just to see what's happening. Now, another thing, I don't like to just spend money just for the sake of spending money, but we spent $1,242 on postage to get a survey. $1,242 worth of postage. And then they got a phone call on top of that saying that a survey was coming. And we get back what percent, Jeff?
8%.
So what does that tell me? Tell them the same thing that they told me in 6 years ago when I ran for this board, that they really don't care. So I take that kind of seriously, that if they don't care and they voted me in, then I'm supposed to do the best I know how. And the best I know how right now is to vote for this calendar that we've just adopted, or going to adopt.
Yeah, a couple of questions, really. I agree that best learning process for our high school students would be the new proposed calendar, because we would not have loss of learning in between Christmas break and then having to go back for exams. I also believe that the best things for our families would be to have a similar calendar. What I don't know is the best way to achieve both things. I think that we should try to ask for a waiver for both. Whether or not it's granted, we don't know. It's more likely that it will be granted for the high school than for the whole system, but it surely cannot hurt us to go ahead and ask for both if that's what we want, and if more counties in North Carolina will continue to ask for waivers, then maybe finally the legislature will see that this is what the people want, is to have a similar calendar for all schools. I don't know the best way to achieve it, and I guess what we need to establish is, do we have to, first of all, pass the high school and calendar first before we ask for the waiver? Or can we ask for the waiver without?
I think part of the process is the Board of Education would have to have a calendar that we would be asking them to consider for waiver purposes.
Mr. Chairman, why are we not then including everybody in the calendar and requesting for one waiver for the system versus singling out? I've got very mixed emotions about this, and hearing even tonight just causes me some more concern when we're looking at family situations and folks coming back to work and having to adjust. I just find that if everybody's on the same calendar, it makes scheduling for families a whole lot easier, for our teachers that are in our system easier. And then the thing that we did not consider, every, even though they may not be immediately impacted, sooner or later, these kids that stay in our system, those parents, are going to be impacted. And we only have 8% return from the 8th through 11th graders, but the other parents that are in our system were never even considered to ask how they even felt about it, because sooner or later, they will be impacted. And I think we just left out a large portion of it. I would rather, I'd say my for the vote, but I've just got mixed emotions, very mixed.
And I'd like to reply to what Mr. Thomas said about the $1,200. Is that approximately what the survey cost?
The postage.
So I would also say, in these economic times, it's going to cost way more than $1,200 for these teachers to get daycare and make arrangements for kids for these couple of weeks. They're going to have to make arrangements. $1,200 is small. Excuse me?
11 days.
Yeah, still, $1,200 is, if we had to do the survey over again, I just think we ought to get it right. 7.8% is pitiful. That's not, Andy did a good job. I'm sure the staff did a good job getting it out there, no doubt about it. But I think the community and the public, you know, we sometimes want a second chance. I just think we ought to get it right.
But I think even in the survey, I guess, you know, Mr. Bryant, you would have knowledge of this. A lot of the, you know, the surveys went to the homes where we had high school, middle school, you know, elementary. They were all in the same home, and to get such a low return, you know, I know it, that does, it looks really bad. But you and I know, just when you send out a survey, for some odd reason, you just don't get a high percentage. And I'll give you one example. This is personal. At the college, they have to evaluate me every time I teach every semester. Every student, I give them time to go to the computer to do it. And this last semester, I only had 8 students to evaluate me. It was high, but I only had 8 students out of all of the students. So you just don't get a high, you know, a high return. I don't know why.
I'd like that form of privilege, please. I'd like to just say this. I have 2 questions, and only 2. This is directed to Andy. I think you somewhat quarterback the committee. I think everybody on this board knows that I'm very strong in support of committees. My question is, did the committee as a whole evaluate points that have been raised here tonight and brought forth to the administration, or vice versa? Was this administrative driven committee? Did administration drive the committee, or the committee bring to the as a function of the committee, the calendar committee?
We had 3 different calendar committees to consider all the different calendars that we have. And in the first calendar committee, we actually went in with a sort of a draft calendar just as a place for people to start. And we got about halfway through meeting, and a couple of parents actually brought up the idea of, you know, is there any way to do a separate high school calendar? And that's where it originally came from. Parents talking about the issues. And at that point, we took their idea, made no promises to anyone, just to take the idea of considering what would it even look like. And then we went to work and put another draft calendar together that would consider a split calendar. And probably 2 days after that meeting, sent that back out to every committee member for consideration, and also to ask them to seek feedback from other people that they represent. 43 members of the committee representing each of our 16 schools. And from that point on, it was a discussion of the committee. This is my opinion as chair of that committee. It was discussion of those teachers and parents, And we reached a consensus by the end of that, that the committee was very emphatic that they wanted to hear community input survey. And in putting that survey together, we constructed that survey based upon the comments of that committee and the points that they saw as being issues resolved pertaining to the high school committee. We felt like that when we walked out of the committee, we had everybody had a safe environment, they could say what they wanted to say, and I honestly believe that there was consensus. Once again, my perspective on that.
So the bottom line is, the staff reacted to the committee in their direction that they took, committee took.
It was a parental idea that we put a draft together for to take back to them to consider.
So the effort of the committee to engage all parents was initiated by the survey?
It was initiated by the survey to engage the community and the parents on that. And then as a member of that committee, all committee members know that they have a task to go back after that committee meeting and talk with their fellow teachers and parents and community members.
Okay, my second question, and I'll close with a comment. The only point that's been, I've had two phone calls. Neither parent objected to the calendar at Christmas, the completion of the, but it was all personal that they just preferred not having yet another calendar to conflict with children that they had in their family. In one case, they had one in the middle school and one in the high school and would have that for 2 years. They were not, they did not strongly object. It was just a point being made. But beyond that, I've had no more calls or inquiries. One issue that was brought up tonight, however, has to do with football. I'm just in the dark on that as a point of discussion. Was there ever in a committee that you recall anything about a football schedule or a football program?
The discussion that came out of the committee was not a reference to football. The reference that was made in the committee was about athletics. And it was a very small point at that, talking about all the different sport teams that start. But it was one of numerous comments that were made around the table, I'm not going to speak for the committee, but I can say what I heard in the committee. And the issue that rose to the forefront of the committee was academics, and it involved taking exams, whether we're going to take exams in December or January, and what is academically more beneficial for our students. And that was the primary and main concern.
So athletics, and specifically football, was not part of the effort to make the recommendation that's before us?
It was mentioned sort of after the fact as a, hey, here's another potential advantage for it.
Well, you've reinforced my questions. That the committee took time from their schedule, parents and others, and their objectivity, and I don't mean to put words in your mouth or theirs, in their objectivity, the calendar before us represents that calendar committee.
I believe it does, yes, sir.
Okay.
Two more things, Ms. Jen, I'm done. How many questions was on that survey, Andy?
We made it pretty straightforward. It was one question.
Well,
either
yes
or agree or don't agree.
Okay, thank you.
We received a copy of it.
may have been on the road and I may not have seen it, but I just wanted to know. Lastly, is there anything that would prevent us from doing an online survey, providing parents with, across our system, with an opportunity to vote online? And the question, the reason why I ask that is, several factors come in. It's a book bag survey. The students take it home and the students return it.
Yes, sir.
That's what I'm asking.
We mailed it to the house.
And how do they get returned?
The return to the students.
Okay. Same difference. The student has a choice, just as they do with the homework, whether they're going to turn it in or not, which I think may have skewed some of the survey numbers. But our question is, do we have an ability, I guess my first question is, if we were to table this for a month, would it kick us out of any kind of, if we waited a month and we did a survey, would it hurt us in any way?
It would hurt the process to request the waiver from the Department of Public Instruction.
Why?
They only hear waivers twice a year. November and February, I think it is.
There's a February 1 deadline.
That's the only, but in, to answer your first question is, yes, SurveyMonkey and many others out there offer online survey capabilities. The only issue with that I've seen in the past is who has access. And access is a big issue when you talk about online surveys.
And that's what I was saying, if we gave each parent their kid's NCY's number.
No, I'm talking about literally access to the internet to get out there to take the survey in their households. I mean, it would be nice to think that every household has internet and they have a computer that they can go on, but that's not reality. So the issue then becomes access. Then will they go to the public library? Where will they go to have access to take the survey?
Thank you, sir. Unless objection by the board, I think we've given this its due time for discussion. All thoughts were well presented. We did have good dialogue. At this time, I ask that the motion before us to approve the calendar as submitted by the calendar committee, that those in favor of the proposal by the committee to signify by aye.
Aye.
And those in opposition signify by likewise.
Aye.
We have split 3-3. The chairman would exercise this privilege in breaking a tie to vote in favor. As I've said before, I'm strong on committees. I support the committee. Therefore, I support the motion carries 4-3. Next on the agenda is the motion to approve the waiver request of the calendar that was just approved. Do I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approves submitting a waiver request for the high school calendar.
Second.
Second by Mr. Williams. All in favor or any discussions now regarding the waiver request? Being none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
No. That record show one opposition. At this time, next on the item is the year-round and the early college calendars. I have a motion to approve the year-round and the early college.
Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education approve the year-round and the early college calendars for first reading.
Second
by Ms. Smith. Any questions or discussions? Being none, those in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Those opposed. This time we recognize and we will need a motion and a second regarding the project memorandum of understanding regarding the Race to the Top grant. May I have a motion?
Mr. Chair, I move the Lee County Board of Education approve the Race to the Top grant project memorandum of understanding.
Second.
Second by Mr. Williams. Any discussions or questions as to what you're voting for on this memorandum of understanding?
Can you get an explanation on this, sir? Just an overview.
Yeah. This is part of the Recovery Act. $4.35 billion was given to the Secretary of Education to come up with what he's titled Race to the Top for states. It's a competitive grant program that each state will be able to compete to receive a percentage of that $4.35 billion. For North Carolina, it's somewhere around $400 million per year for 5 years. It will be distributed and disseminated based upon your Title I enrollment. So, and we could receive anywhere from a minimum amount up to that $400 million. I don't know exactly what our dollar amount would be in Lee County until the state receives their grant, but every system would be treated the same based upon their Title I enrollment.
I may add also, according to what I was briefed by the superintendent, the governor's office is requesting this of each LEA in the state to show solidarity. I recognize Vicki Wilkins in the audience. She's here taking time, waiting to hear what the board action is. It requires not only the superintendent's signature and my own signature, it does require the NCAA local chapter president's signature. This is an opportunity, I guess you would say, that we may receive some additional stimulus money here in Lee County. Any other questions?
I would like to ask Dr. Moss a question. Mm-hmm. I am intrigued. We had this conversation last week that only 8 states will be chosen for these grants, that is correct?
Approximately 8 states.
Wonder why 8, why the number 8? What is it?
To put a critical amount of money out there to actually allow a state to make an impact. If it's spread out over all states, then it gets diluted down to the point that they don't feel that much of an impact could be made.
And then those 8 states would then philosophically share what they've done with this money to the remaining states. Well, would remaining states get money to implement similar changes?
That I don't know.
They might hear it the next time.
Recovery number 2.
No further questions. All in favor of the motion before you, signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ms. Mangum, item 7 is for the amended agenda.
And I don't know how to word this, and I don't know how it's going to work. But what I wanted us to consider was also asking a waiver for our elementary and middle schools to adopt a calendar that would mirror the high school, based on the fact that the high school calendar would be more advantageous for our high school students and not to disrupt family life within our county.
How about this, Ms. Mayne, let's plagiarize the waiver that we have from Ms. Mayne, motion to move that Lee County Board of Education approve submitting a waiver for the LEA request for the entire LEA what is our number? Yeah, 503.
The way waivers are typically written for this waiver, you would actually be approving having us submit a system-wide waiver for calendar issues for the purpose of not disconnecting families and
which would enhance their academic achievement. It can't hurt.
No, it cannot. That's true. Never hurts to ask.
That's a motion by Ms. Mangum. Second by Linda Smith. Any questions or discussions on this? Being none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Dr. Smith.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Lee County Board of Education go into closed session for the purpose of discussing information that is privileged, confidential, or not a public record under North Carolina General Statute, Section 143.318.11A1.
I have a second to the motion.
Second.
All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Adjourn to the conference room. You ready?
Okay.
I'd like to have a motion from the floor, please, on adoption of the personnel report.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we approve the personnel report as presented.
Second.
Second. All in favor signify by aye.
Aye. Mr. Chairman, I move for adjournment.
Second. We stand adjourned.
I got that.